Hey guys, welcome to the Learn Feng Shui podcast, where you'll learn Feng Shui from a classical point of view, taking out the myth and superstition. So if you're interested in learning Feng Shui, Chinese astrology, all things Chinese metaphysics, as well as the superstitions and myths that connect it all, you'll enjoy learning Feng Shui with me. Hey guys, today we're going to talk about altar placement, where to place those cremation remains, you know, feng shui for those urns, as well as feng shui for burial and honoring our ancestors during Qing Ming, known as Tomb Sweeping Festival. Hey guys, welcome to today's episode. I'm Candace Berling, a certified feng shui practitioner and red ribbon professional with the International Feng Shui Guild. So today we're going to focus on feng shui for altars, look at those altar placements, and look at feng shui for cremation urns and remains. You know, there's definitely considerations when you kind of look at where the altar placement is. You know, what we put on it may vary because perhaps you're a certain religion and you believe in certain things. So today we're touching more on altar placement and, you know, kind of those altar, what are called feng shui forms. And surprisingly, they're a lot like the forms for placing a bed or even placing your desk. So we'll take a look at that. And then we're also going to look at feng shui for burial, some of the considerations that are made, as well as honoring our ancestors for Qing Ming, which is known as Tomb Sweeping Festival. So it is that time of year. All right, let's get into it. Feng Shui for altars. Let's start with that first. All right, so before we move on to looking at the forms and how to set up the altar, like where's the best place, let's talk about the objects that go on our altar. I know I said I wasn't going to talk about specific objects, and I'm not. And that's because, you know, as a society, we're all different religions. You know, feng shui is not a religion. And so within feng shui, we have every religion, I would say. And so what you want to do is you want to make sure that the objects you're setting on the altar do connect to you and they have some sort of special meaning to you. And I say that because within Taoist beliefs, even if you're not Taoist, they do believe that if your items haven't been like blessed or they're not like active, then they're not going to be working to protect you. And this goes for both deities that are placed on altars and protective items, protective sigils, you know. And so one of the things they do is something called an open eye ceremony. And they do this at the temples, and then different Taoist masters can do it too. But basically what is done is the items are taken to the Taoist master, the Taoist priest, for the open eye ceremony. And they usually do some sort of chanting, you know, burn the incense, burning sigils around it. And they'll usually dot it with a red dot. And that's usually cinnabar, and sometimes it's mixed with the blood from a rooster's comb, like the little comb on top of their head. And then this is believed that this item is active and it's working to protect you in your home and your altar and wherever you place it. You know, you should honor that object. And, you know, it's the same thing for our items we have on our altar, right? We don't want to just go to Hobby Lobby and buy some kind of cross and, you know, stick that up. But perhaps you're Catholic and you really feel like the Virgin Mary, you know, is there to protect you, or you connect with different saints. You know, these are the things you're going to want to put on your altar. For example, I did buy a Milagro cross. We went to Santa Fe last summer and we went up into the mountains, and there was a church there, and it was said to have healing waters and healing dirt and stuff like that. And so I bought the Milagro cross from there. And so to me, that's special. You know, it's been blessed by the priests, you know, that see over that church, you know? And so these are the things you're going to want to put on your altar. Again, just with Taoist beliefs, it is believed that once this item has been embodied, or like you put this intention into it, you know, you really focus your attention on this protective energy, that, you know, this energy does manifest within that deity. And so same thing for you. You know, you may have a special item that was passed down to you, maybe a necklace or some jewelry or even just crystals and stuff like that. Whatever you feel like you connect with and has energy for you, place those items on your altar. Looking at where to place the altar within your home, you know, it would be really nice if I could tell you, like, place it in the, you know, south, or place it in the west or whatever. But that's not really the case, because honestly, We're, you know, usually limited when it comes to what we're going to put in our homes, right? We don't have that option. And so where we're going to look at is what's called the feng shui forms. And the forms really is the location within the home that you place things, or the location within the room, okay? And so when we look at direction and location, you know, those are two different things, you know. Again, you can have things facing in a certain direction, but if it doesn't make sense for the room, then that's not really good feng shui. So we're going to look at where we place this altar within the room you choose to place it in. So just kind of a general rule of thumb, anything looking at feng shui, you're going to want to follow what's called these forms first and foremost, because again, you can place your, you know, altar somewhere, but if it doesn't make sense and if it's in an awkward position, then it's not really going to be a benefit to you. And so just kind of the rule of thumb, and honestly with anything, is you're going to want to follow the same rules that you follow when you place your bed or you're placing a desk. And so you're going to want to make sure your altar is placed up against a solid wall, make sure the area is tidy and clean, and make sure there's not oppressive energies overhead like ceiling beams or sloped roofs. Don't place it underneath stairs. Okay, so just some of those basic forms. Somewhere you wouldn't put a bed, or it wouldn't make sense for you to put a work desk, you know, don't place your altar there. And speaking of stairs, you are going to want to avoid placing an altar on the same wall that it shares with the stairs behind it. And so, if that makes sense, it's hard to explain. So, I know in my living room, I have like a little half wall, and behind that is the stairs, right? And so, I would want to avoid placing my altar on that little half wall because there's stairs behind it. Likewise, you're going to want to avoid placing your altar where it shares the same wall as a couple's bedroom or a stove, you know, we're gonna wanna make sure that's not aligned. So, just like you would think with a bed, like I mentioned earlier, you know, avoiding placing it underneath a window, you're gonna wanna avoid it underneath a TV or an aquarium. So, we're not gonna wanna have these items near our altar either. Do avoid placing your altar too close to the television and an aquarium, especially right underneath it. And so you're going to want to make sure that there's not like water on top of it, especially for that fire energy of the altar. And then of course that TV, we want to make sure it's just, I feel like it's too much of an active energy. And so don't, you know, if you have like your TV mounted on the wall or something, don't place your altar directly below it. It's also said that you don't want to place your altar in direct sunlight. I think you do want the energy to be a little bit more yin. You know, I always remember my grandmother who had her altar inside her closet. She just had like a small trailer that she lived in, but you open her closet and there was the Virgin Mary, there was candles, and you know, there was some other little items there. And so she always had a little nook inside her closet. So you can definitely you know, keep this in mind when you're setting your stuff up. You could, you know, put a little nook, but again, make sure it's not oppressed under ceiling beams and stuff like that. You know, don't try and force it into a closet if it doesn't make sense to you. For me, it made sense to her. It just was just a little area she used. You also want to make sure that you're keeping your altar out of your bedroom. I know living rooms and areas like that are typically better for an altar. And again, there is areas, you know, you can place it so you could look at the south or the north, or you could look at eight mansions and look at certain directions within eight mansions. But I know just as a society, we're kind of limited in the space we have. You know, not everyone has the option to put their altar in the perfect ideal spot. And so again, just look at where it makes sense to you and follow the forms when placing your altar. Some altars do have a little space underneath them, like they kind of look like a TV cabinet, right? If you're buying a traditional altar for altar's sake, okay? And so you're not going to want to place like water here. And some people like do aquariums, make it look cool, or they place their little deity there. And so this is a specific spot for the earth deity. It's not for these heaven deities. And so again, it just kind of depends on your religion and stuff and what you pray for, but there's not supposed to be an empty like slot or space underneath the altar, and definitely don't put water in this area. Another consideration is going to be the offerings that you're putting out. So, especially if you're putting out like food, drink, and like flowers, you know, those things tend to spoil quite quickly in hot weather. And so we're going to want to make sure that you're, you know, changing those offerings out very often and making sure they don't get stinky or spoiled. I know it's said that if they, you know, things start spoiling very quickly, that the god is supposed to be gone from the altar. So you're probably going to want to re-bless or reconsecrate that area if you notice that your offerings are spoiling really fast. One last consideration is the incense sticks that you're using. Sometimes they're just called joss sticks, but you're going to want to either put a odd number of candles or incense sticks, because again, that's supposed to be the number of heaven. And so usually one or three is kind of the, I suppose the traditional, you know, it's a traditional to put one or three up. And you're also going to want to take note of the way those things are burning. And I know in certain religions or certain practices, you can actually look at the way a candle burns down, or look at the flame on the candle, or even look at the way the stick is burning, and whether or not it lights and stuff like that. And so if you're one to subscribe to doing that and you kind of know the meaning behind that, do pay attention on to the way that those items are burning on that altar. And if you are setting up a Taoist altar, I'm going to include a link because it goes into detail about certain items. I know there's very specific item placement, placing your incense burner in a certain area, placing candles in a certain area, if you have a deity, and if you have ancestor plaques, you're going to want to set that up according to your religious belief. Please make sure you follow the feng shui for placement and items on that altar. Now, also one thing is if you do have your altar set up, you want to make sure you either have like lighting or candles that are going all the time. Again, this is a fire energy. You're going to want to make sure you pray daily and you have incense set there. And so that's just kind of a rule of thumb. Don't set up an altar if you don't feel like you're really going to be using it. Now looking at feng shui for cremation remains, I think this is something that, you know, I don't know if we talk a lot about it with feng shui. I know the feng shui belief is that it's, you know, you don't want yin energy within your home, but let's be realistic. Like people, you know, maybe you're not in a place where you want to settle down and you want to intern those remains, right? You need to have them with you, right? You don't want to be moving around and not being able to visit your loved one at their burial space, you know, and I get that. But you do want to make sure that you're honoring that person by putting their cremation remains in an area that is revered. So, you know, a lot of places that you are going to want to keep it out of the bedroom. I will say that. Let's put that out of the bedroom, but a living room, you know, a family room, maybe you even have a room dedicated for the altar. You know, you can put it on that altar. You know, we can do that. So we want to make sure that we're putting it in a space that it's just, you know, it makes sense for you, but it's also honoring that person. And I found a great article of fengshuimanhattan.com. You know, again, this is something that isn't necessarily talked about with, you know, I learned from an Eastern teacher, you know, and they, again, kind of subscribe to keep it out, the remains out, you know, or intern them. And here, you know, I feel like in the West, we are more flexible of having those remains. It doesn't like creep us out. You know, it doesn't make us feel a certain way, you know. And so there's some really great suggestions in here. It says, besides urn placement, take into consideration the atmosphere and how you choose to display this urn. There's already a lot of yin energy. So if the urn remains within your home for a short or prolonged period of time, it would be wise to bring in more yang energy to kind of balance that out. And it says here, a way to do that is just put living plants into the space where you'll be displaying the ashes, you know, kind of balance it out that way. Place the urn in a location that receives natural daylight. Display a photo of the person and be sure that you choose a happy and healthy image. So don't place one of them when they were sick, you know, place one of them maybe at their prime. Place a ceremonial cloth beneath the urn, maintain a clean table and shelf where the urn is placed, and allow the urn to be close to eye level versus being placed too close to the floor. And displaying a universal symbol or symbols that you choose that unify living and deceased in a respectful way. Oh, I love those suggestions. All right. right, guys, taking a quick mid-show breather here. We'll get to Folklore Friday, Feng Shui for burial, and venerating our ancestors during Tomb Sleeping Festival. Don't have a lot of announcements. Learnfengshui.com. Check out the newsletter there on that blog post, the monthly newsletter. I work pretty hard getting that done, so I'm actually quite proud of it. It's one of my favorite things that I've incorporated into this, into the website. One thing I don't talk a lot about is leaving reviews for the podcast. So if you don't like the podcast, why are you listening? If you do like it, go leave a review, you know? So, yeah, I know when I first started doing the podcast, I have some bad iTunes reviews because it was just me literally in a closet with my headphones. So, just in a dream, in a dream. So upgraded a little bit. I didn't have all the equipment. I didn't even have show structure. So, I've learned as I've gone, but I feel like I've improved quite a bit, So if you like the show, go review it. If you don't like it, stop listening. Anyway, let's go ahead and go to our next segment here, Folklore Friday, Feng Shui for burial and honoring our ancestors. Truly it's said that where Xing Qi is manifested on the surface of the earth, underground Qi accumulates vitality. Where Qi flourishes, although it flows away, still there is some retention of its surplus, and although it dissipates, there is still some accumulation in its depth. And that is a quote from Guo Pu's burial book, one of the first feng shui texts ever written. And again, feng shui does come from burial. It was the first application of feng shui and was later translated into homes for the living. But commenting on that quote, it's believed that the qi, it does accumulate and it is stored underground also. And so when we're buried, this energy, this vital energy does go into our bones, and that benefits our descendants, And so the first thing we can look at when we look at feng shui for burial is soil quality. Again, that five color soil, I kind of talked about when we did soil quality last year. I may revamp that episode there because it was pretty interesting. But there's different soil qualities you can consider, and there's different colors and all kinds of stuff of soil. And again, we're kind of limited to where we're living, right? We can't always choose the soil that we're buried in. But one thing we do want to avoid is a soil that's too rocky, gravelly, and hard to dig in. So if you have really dry soil, that does indicate that there's not a lot of qi of flowing in that soil. And then you're going to want to avoid soggy soil. And so we know if you are a gardener like me, when you have soggy soil, that can lead to a whole host of problems. We want proper drainage, because then we can get things like rotting and stuff like that. And I think the kind of consensus or the thought is you don't want your bones to rot, right? They're supposed to be maybe even kind of preserved with this soil and get vitality from the soil. And so those are just some considerations. Also, if you hit a spring or there's water, underground water underneath, this is not ideal for burial. And kind of going with the soil quality, one thing you want to look for also is lush vegetation. This is said to be a sign that the qi is good in an area, making it suitable also for burial. Another really big consideration back in the day, again, we can't really choose this because, we live where we live. We want to be buried where we want to be buried, maybe your hometown does not have mountain contours and water around it. And I know mine does not, there's not a lot around there. But those are definitely things that are considered, are mountain contours and water shapes. There's supposed to be all sorts of different formations within the mountains where you can be buried for, it's almost these meridian points within the mountain. I know when you have mountain contours, kind of the way the burial book explains it is when you have these mountain contours, there's usually a place of flat land, and that is where the qi is said to accumulate, and that is supposed to be ideal for burial. Again, when we're looking at cemeteries, we are a little bit limited, but this is just what the ancient texts say. Another factor that we consider would be wind. So wind is a factor in burial also. So we know that feng shui translates to wind and water. And that actually does come also from the burial book, where it states that qi is dispersed by the wind and gathers at the boundaries of water. But blowing wind is too strong, it can actually dissipate that qi since it does scatter it. So it does say here, you want it to not be so windy that the wind is eroding parts of the tomb. And it says here that a layer with leakage will only harbor a decaying coffin. So that is also considered negative. And really, that's probably also more of a consideration when you do have tombs that are, I suppose, mausoleum type, or if you're buried above ground sometimes. I know there's some parts of the US here where the water table's low and you have to bury above ground. And I know that there's those, kind of crypt type things too. So, I think burial in a crypt, this would also be a consideration. We can also look at landform around the tomb, which we see this more again, I think, in Chinese traditional tombs. Again, you just got to go look at it, but it has the four guardians, the four celestial creatures, which is the red phoenix, so the energy coming in from the front. The left side should have the green dragon, which the green dragon is, it's going to be higher on the left side. And so we have that energy. And then the white tiger, which does have an embrace, but a little bit lower and maybe just a slight contour on the right side. And then the black tortoise, which is behind you, which is the backing. It's supposed to be higher in the back to hold in the chi. And so, again, much like our homes, when we look at this energy, they look at the same way for feng shui, for burial. And it wouldn't be feng shui if we didn't look at the direction of burial sites too. And so here's what the classic said about different burial sites in directions. It says burial sites in the direction of Qin, which is northwest, require a contour that rises and falls continuously, and the features should be broad and square. So I'm thinking the contours that rise and fall are a metal element because they're kind of round shaped, and broad and square because that is earth shape, and earth does support the energy of metal. It gives birth to it. So we look at the element cycle there. Burial sites in the direction of Kun, which is southwest, does require a contour that's like a partition screen with no incline, and the feature should be broad and level. I'm thinking a little more flat. Remember, Kun is yin earth. And so I guess you want features that also support the direction site burial energy. Sites in the direction of Gun, which is northeast, require a contour that's sinuous and yielding. The features should be lofty, steep peaks. I had to look up lofty. It just means like large and imposing, in case you didn't know, because I didn't. So, again, kind of keeping with that mountain energy there. Sites in the direction of Sun, which is the southeast, require a contour that is lofty and luxuriant. The features should be sharp and imposing. And I'm thinking tall, sharp mountain peaks, maybe in the support the energy of wood. Sites that are in the direction of Jun, which is east, require contours that are gradual and harmonious. Features should be towering and commanding. Again, tall cylindrical shapes to for the metal. Sorry, for the wood element. Okay, sites in the direction of Li requires contours that spread and arch, and features should be rising and lofty. I'm surprised I didn't talk about like pointy either, because Li is the south, which is fire. So it just says rising and lofty. Maybe tall represents that fire energy. Sites in direction of Dui, which is the west, contour to advance majestically with ascending slopes. Features should be square and level. Again, I think the square is that earth energy supporting the metal. Sites in direction of Kan, which is the north, requires contours that are long and winding. Features should be luxuriant, verticals, and lofty. And of course, the windy, wavy features do represent that energy of water. And there is a lot of consideration also for interning a urn. And so when we're looking at placing ashes and putting those in a niche, you do want to consider some different things here. And so it is quite complicated. And I mean, honestly, if I explained it, you wouldn't really understand, unless you've been practicing feng shui. So it does have to do a lot with, the five elements and date selection, the level of the slot, the direction that the slot faces. Like all of those have an element to them. And you want to make sure that it does support the person's bazi or their natal chart. And one of the ways that this is done is using something called the Na Yin. And so the Na Yin is known sometimes as the melodic element. And each of the 60 different zodiac signs combine to make their own element. So, for example, even this year, though this year is the year of the wood dragon, and wood, is that heavenly stem, and the dragon is the element of earth. It's the earth branch, is earth. The Na Yin, or when those kind of combine, I suppose, they make their own element, and that's called like fire from the lamp. So it's like basically fire. And so all these things are taken into consideration when looking at interment for ashes also. And of course, all of the feng shui for burial, urn placement and everything, it does require the use of date selection for a good date. And date selection is always done in conjunction with the burial, the interment, and setting the headstone. So it can get quite complex, as you may know. These are only a portion of some of the factors that are used. It can get very complex. So I've even heard of two brothers. Like I read a while back, there were these two brothers that were fighting for the perfect burial date because they thought it one, you know, one date would benefit another brother more than the other date. So, we can't always choose these things, you know? And so one thing I would say also is use your common sense when it comes to, looking at feng shui for burial or whatever. There's certain red flags. Here where I live in West Texas, it's very flat. We don't have the land contour. We don't have lush vegetation. We don't really have water unless there's some set up by the cemetery. One of our cemeteries here where I live has water, and we actually bought a burial niche facing the water for my father-in-law, right? And so there's some common sense things you can use if it feels good to you, if you have the means to pick a plot. A lot of people, plan their own funerals. Just use your common sense. Like me and my kids were taking a drive a couple years ago, and one of the things I had to stop because there was a cemetery right on the highway, and the highway was actually rerouted and curved right around the cemetery. So I'm guessing that they put the highway through after they put the cemetery, but the graves were very, very close to the highway, and I can't help thinking that that's just not good feng shui. So when you're looking at spaces, right, we want to make sure we're picking kind of the space that makes sense for you. So if you go out and you visit it, you want to pick a spot ahead of time. Just make sure it feels good to you. Like, does this spot in the cemetery feel good? Especially if it's like a family plot and you want to be buried by your relatives. Like, these are all things you need to consider too. So don't get too caught up on finding a perfect date and time and, all of these things. Sometimes we just have to work with what we got, especially when it comes to funerals. Can't always pick a perfect funeral date or time or, even spot, but as long as you feel good about it, and you feel like things have gone well, say your prayers to the heavens, I think things will turn out pretty good for you. And just a reminder that this time of year is Qing Ming or tome sweeping festival. It's a time of year where Southeast Asian countries, Chinese countries, they honor their ancestors, and venerate them. The legend actually comes from a man named Ji Jitsu, who was a loyal servant of a Chinese lord. He helped his lord survive through exile, and in order to prevent his lord from starving, it's quite grim, he actually cut a piece of his own leg and fed it to his lord. So he survived the ordeal, and the lord returned to power 19 years later. But sadly enough, by this time, you forget about those who help you, right? He said he had forgotten about G's service. Can't imagine. Can you imagine being so devoted to somebody that you literally take a piece of yourself to keep them alive, and they come back into power and they're like, "No, I don't know you. They forgot about you. Just forgot all about it." Anyhow, sometime later he did remember. So he remembered G's service and felt regretful about forgetting. Felt pretty bad. I'd feel pretty bad too. So the Lord intended to reward G, but by the time he found him, G had passed. And to honor the life and death of G, the Lord established Qing Ming as a holiday to commemorate the dead. And it is also used as a celebration of spring And for that reason, different activities during this time are also like kite flying, just spending time outside, going to the park. And then, of course, burning incense and stuff, flowers, cleaning the tombs of your relatives. So if you don't have time or you don't live near your relatives that you want to honor, in the newsletter here on the website, learnfengshui.com, I did put in a little thing about some in-house feng shui and honoring your ancestors. And so you can, of course, visit the graves, clean up the headstones, and place flowers. But if you don't have time to do that, maybe you don't live near them, research your family tree or learn about your relatives. So spend some time and listen to stories from the elders. I feel like mine are all dying off. I'm 42, so my elders are like my mom. I mean, she's, my aunt, my great aunts. I only have one left. So my grandma passed, 2010. So we don't have a lot of those elders left. So spend some time with them. Setting up an ancestor altar or placing pictures out of loved ones that have passed in a special area. I know many people you do view that at East sector as the family sector and associate it with family and ancestors. So you can definitely put those out in the East. Go through your old funeral programs. I know I keep like prayer cards and the little programs from the funerals. I typically keep those, but I do have a memory box that I put them in and I keep them in there because I don't want to look at them all the time, Alternatively, you can burn these items to release them if you feel the memories are sad. So you don't feel like you have to hold on to things, but maybe storing them or burning them can help bring you some closure. So offer a prayer or spend some time in reflection if you feel you need closure with a loved one that has already passed. So these are my ways to, honor your ancestors aside from just cleaning the tombs. All right, guys. Well, I hope you enjoyed today's episode. Maybe you learn a little bit about the history of feng shui and, kind of where it came from. Setting up your altar, stuff like that. So let me know if you found this useful. So again, go to the website and I'll catch you guys next week for cannabis use in ancient China as well as Xinyang, the father of Chinese medicine. For a free wonder room consultation or energy mapping of your space, follow the link in the show notes. To support the podcast, share with your family and friends, leave a review, or go to learnfengshui.com.